Hi and welcome again to this tutorial in Revit for beginners. This is the part 5. And here we will learn how to hide and isolate objects, to understand how the hierarchy nomenclature works, and how to create stairs in your projects. Let's start! Hide, isolate elements. In this chapter we are going to learn to hide and isolate elements. I'm going to switch to the 3D view in this project. What can you see here? After creating the floor for the second level, everything below is now hard to see. Here I can just view a tiny part across this gap in the middle. However, in Revit, it's possible to hide the elements in some certain views. I'm going to show you. I select this floor. Then, on the status bar, you can see these glasses over here. This is the feature to temporarily hide and isolate objects. I click on it and then there are several options. Let's choose Hide Element and you can no longer see the floor. Nonetheless, all the other views in this project, floor plans, elevations and so on, remain unchanged. This is important. Now let's hide another element. For example, this window. I hide the element. And you can see that it's also temporarily hidden, and the floor still remains switched off. Notice also this blue frame around the workspace, temporary hide isolate objects. It's always there when I have temporary, hidden or isolate elements. How to isolate a category? This time I select the door and choose hide category. And you can notice that all the elements from the same category, doors, are hidden. The opposite of hide is isolate. If instead I isolate this window, that hides all the remaining objects, except the window here. To turn off the temporary hide isolate, I can click on Reset Temporary Hide Isolate. And everything is shown again, including the floor. If I just want to return to the previous temporary hide isolate state, just press Ctrl-Z. With isolate category, I show on this view just a specific category of objects. This time I did it to the doors. An important information, the temporary hide isolate ceases to have effect once I save and close the file. If I come back tomorrow, all the elements that I have in this view are visible again. But is it possible to permanently hide elements in a view? Yes, have a look at this floor plan. Suppose I need a view of this floor plan that doesn't have the furniture and plumbing fixtures in the toilet. In order to not modify this view, I go to the project browser, right-click on the current view, ground floor, and select Duplicate. There are several options to duplicate views, but we will go through them later. A copy of the ground floor is created. Now I can rename the view in a way that I understand better what it represents. Let's put ground floor without furniture. I confirm it. Then I'm going to select an element, for example this table. I right-click. Go to Hide in View and choose Element. What I did was hiding the table in this view permanently. If instead I choose Hide Category, all the furniture elements are hidden. As the water closet and the sink are part of a different category, plumbing fixtures, I need to repeat the process for them. And note that category is the first identity that appears when I hover an element. We will go through this later, on the next chapter. These elements are permanently hidden in this floor plan. I can save the file, open it again, and the view remains the same. And by just looking at the screen, there is no way to know that some objects are hidden in this view. But how can I check out the hidden elements? Click on the bulb at the status bar, Reveal Hidden Elements, so I can see which elements are hidden from this current view. They are displayed in red. To unhide any element or category, I select one, for example this table, With the right click, go to Unhide and choose Category. This time the option element is not available, because before I hid the category of this table. So the elements are now displayed. I click on the bulb to exit Reveal Elements, and I can do the same for the toilet. Look, there is also a section element hidden here. I have hidden it previously on the ground floor view, but I can select it and unhide it. Hierarchy terminology. Now let's talk a bit about the hierarchy of elements in Revit. It's important that we understand these concepts. Any element in Revit, for example, let's use as an example this window, falls into three hierarchy states: category, we mentioned it in the previous chapter, family, and type. And each time you hover any element, you can see each of them. Basically, category is the top of hierarchy, in this case is windows. M window casement double is the family. And the size that appears here is the type, the family type. When we want to add an element from the Windows category, there are by default three families loaded in the software. You can see here M-fixed window, casement double, and double hung. A family is basically the shape of an element. But of course, not all windows that exist in the world fall into these three shapes. And you can find other families included on the Revit Families library. Let's have a look. I click on Load Family, then I'm going to the folder where I have the window families, and here you have. There are several kinds, as well as windows for the roofs. I'm going to add this one. Then it asks to specify type. And here is when the third hierarchy term comes up. According to Autodesk, a type provides a convenient way to switch several variables of a family at once. For example, the types here differ from each other in the dimensions of the window, but in, for example, a wall, the types differ in the wall thickness and in the materials used. There are several parameters to set in a type, we will learn this later. For now, let's choose just the first type and click on OK. So, at this moment, the action to place a window is active, as you can see on the Modify tab. Let's go now to Properties. Click here to choose the element to insert, and now pay attention to the organization here, as the list is organized by families, and they always have a gray background. Under each family, you can see the types currently available. For example, the newest window family that I just inserted only has the type that I add. The window casement double has four types, for example. However, I can always create a new type. Let's click in this one, then go to Edit Type. And in this window, you can find several parameters to edit. Ah, it's important to know that the parameters may change according to the families or category of the elements. Now, suppose I want to change the dimensions of this type. I could change the values here, but it's not very recommendable unless you know very well what you are doing. For example, these four windows are all from the same type, window casement double 1200x1500. If I change the width, for example, all the elements that I have in the project update their size. And even sometimes this can be useful. We need to be careful. Okay, going back to the triple window, I can create a new type if I press duplicate. It basically copies all the values in these parameters. First, I'm prompted to choose the name for the new type. Let's put 1200x400mm. Of course, this doesn't change anything, it's just a name. Then I search for the dimension section and change the width to 1.2. Yes, in this project I have the units specified as meters. That's why it shows a different unit. And the height 0.4. Return to the list, and now you can see here two types for this family. I'm going to click on this one and place it on the exterior walls. On the next image, you can see a scheme of the hierarchy nomenclature for some window elements. Stairs. In this chapter, we are going to talk about inserting stairs into our project. I should mention that it took me quite a long time to understand how to set the dimensions for the run width and landings properly. And I'm not considering the railings, which I can also set. As all this turns to get a bit complex, I will try to compress the things as simple as I can. And of course, if someone knows any tips that I'm missing, feel free to post in the comments section. Before starting, let's put into practice what we have been learning earlier. In this 3D view, I don't think we need the levels here. They are just confusing, so let's hide them. I think you probably remember how to do this. I select them, right-click, and hide in view, the full category, just in case that I forget to select any element. Now I can create a new 3D view, where I can look inside the ground floor. I'm going to duplicate this current 3D view, rename the 3D copy 1 to, for example, 3D ground floor inside. Just put the name that you want. So in this new view, I'm going to hide this floor, but this time I select element. Otherwise, if I choose category, the floor of the ground floor is also hidden. Select one of the ceilings, hide the category, and there are some lights that I can hide them as well. It looks nice. Now let's create stairs. To add a stair, I click on the icon at the Architecture tab and it opens the sketch mode. Now to start making the stair rises, I need the option Run, and let's start with the default Straight Run. I click for the start point, and then I can draw the stair in the direction that I want. To help me, I can use Shift to draw it vertically. And then, this is important, look at this information saying that I have 11 rises created and 5 remaining. With the current type, I need 16 rises to reach the first floor, which is the top constraint. The riser height is 19 cm. And even it says 190 mm in the name of this type, it's actually an approximate value. The rear riser height is 18.75, as you can see here. So this is important to remind. Always look at the values of the parameters, because they are precise. Okay, now we can look at the settings on the options bar. The location line is at the center, and it's possible to switch here to the sides. The actual run width is set as 1 meter. Okay, now I can click to place the stair, click on the tick to finish the sketch mode, go to the 3D view, and you can now see how it looks like. In the next example, we are going to insert a stair in the L shape, but still using the straight run. I do the same as before, but this time I'm not going to draw all the rises. I leave 5 for a second run. I click, then I click in the exact location where I want to start the first rise of the second run, and the space between will be the landing. Also remember that I am using the location line in the center of the stair. Now look what happens if I choose the start of the riser here. The riser starts from the center, which is not exactly what I want. Okay, I want the second run to start aligning with this line. Click, then move left to finish drawing the stair. As you may realize, I didn't specify the distances, as sometimes it can be a bit hard. But it's not a problem, because we can set those values after. Click on this run, and you can change this distance that says 0.16 to a different value, for example 0.3. If I set 0, the gap between the two runs just disappears. But anyway, let's leave it 0.1. This stair precisely is divided in three sections: a first run, a landing, and a second run. When I click in a section, and remember I'm still in the sketch mode, I can see these controls here. Let's look at them. If I click and hold the grip at the end of the run, I can increase or decrease the number of rises here. But at the same time, on the opposite side, the number of rises updates to keep the desired number, in this case 16. The controls at the sides change the run width. And the same can also be done in the parameter at the properties. When I'm ready with the stair, we need to click on the tick to exit the sketch mode. And remember that it doesn't work with just pressing Enter or Escape. Then I can move the stair where I want, but make sure you click around the middle, because if you click on the railing, what you do is taking out the railing from its place. But it's easy. If all the stair highlights, it means that I am able to select it all and move it to the place that I want. Example 2. First, let's delete the stair that I made before. This time I want to draw the stairs in this space, and I want them aligned with the walls here. First, select this wall, and I'm going to move it slightly to the right, just to have more room here. I will do it by redefining this distance here. Let's increase it to 2.5. Now I activate again the command to insert stairs, but this time change the location line to the right of the run. The start point, I'm going to place it here, and then I'm going to create until here the first 9 risers. I click, then I select the start point of the next run along the left side and place it at this wall. And don't worry if the stair looks a bit deformed, because we can fix this after. Now that I don't have any remaining risers, I can click. In the sketch mode, we can still use the modified tools to each section of the stairs. Here I'm going to use the move command to the run below. I select the section. I click in this endpoint and move the run to this intersection. As you can see, it's not hard. Finally, we click on the tick to confirm the stair placement. Then, if I want to align the stairs to the walls, I can use the Align tool. And if you want to know, it took me quite some time to figure this out when I was learning how to work with stairs. Anyway, I'm going to move a bit out of the wall to be easier for you to understand. I activate Align or press AL. I select this wall side as the reference of alignment, and then click here, and you can see that the stairs move automatically towards the wall. Then click on the lock to constrain this movement. This means that if I move the wall, the stairs also follow to keep the alignment. Right next, I click on this wall at the top for the new reference of alignment, and then select this side. Also click on the constraint, and now you can see that I can move the walls in the direction that I want, and the stairs remain in the corner. It works for both sides. Now let's press Ctrl Z twice and change to the 3D view to have a look at the stairs. However, you can see the stairs going a bit inside the wall here, but this is something we will learn in another chapter in this tutorial. So it was everything for today, and in the next part we will continue with stairs and other important topics in Revit. Thank you very much for watching, and if you have any questions, just publish on the comment section below. I will answer as soon as I can. So, for my side, it's all. See you next time!